Thank you all for joining us today. Good evening. I think we're all like in the Eastern area. If you're in other time zone, good afternoon, good morning. welcome to the Pratt Erks Action Week, Designing Life Center Innovation Innovators webinar. My name is Xue Bai, advisor to the chair in the Creative Enterprise Leadership International Graduate Programs at Pratt Institute. Thank you all for tuning in within your busy schedule. The webinar today is part of a series of events of the Pratt Earth Action Week. It's a week-long program from Monday to Sunday, celebrating the creative collaborations of the Pratt sustainability community and networks. So if you're interested in checking out some other programs, we're happy to drop in the link and you'll be able to see some of the other works from our colleagues and networks on our sustainability initiatives. The webinar today was brought to you by the Catalyst Action Network, CAN. Yes, we can. CAN is an initiative by the Creative Enterprise Leadership International Graduate Programs in Design Management and Arts and Cultural Management at Pratt Institute. The strategic intent of CAN is to deepen our network of program graduates, faculty, and partners from around the world who are leading as if life matters. And you'll meet some of the presenters today to hear about their story and their journey after graduation and a new journey about their entrepreneurship. The network connects our innovative global leadership education to a larger audience through knowledge sharing, experiential learning, and applied research focused on achieving the global goals. We're very fortunate to have three groups of presenters today. They are members of the Action Network, who once upon a time was also program participants of DM and ACM. And I will introduce them and their initiative in a while. So before we begin, I'd like to share some of the housekeeping rules. With the consent of our presenters, the webinar today is going to be recorded and we'll upload to our YouTube channel and also Pratt Talk. So if you're interested in receiving a recording and to review the session, please follow us or send emails to our department and we'll be happy to follow up. If you're interested in learning more about our master degree program, please reach out to us as well, and we'll put our contact in the chat. You can email us at dm@pratt.edu or acm@pratt.edu. So today we're going to have three groups of presenters, and each of them will have about 15 minutes presentation, and we'll leave more time for further communication, discussion, and Q&A in the later section. So while they're presenting, you're welcome to drop in questions in the chat, and we'll happy to connect you with the presenters. Without further ado, I would like to introduce our first presenter, Camila Montoya. She's the founder and the creative director at De Francisco. De Francisco is a jewelry brand based in the US with production in Colombia that launched in 2021. Inspired by nature, De Francisco uses its role in fashion as a means to educate customers on the importance of protecting and respecting the environment. By using 3D printing technology and recycled metals to reduce waste and create sustainable fine jewelry. Camila, we are very happy to have you here today to share your story and your brand. We're happy to learn more about sustainable jewelry.
Thank you, Esno. Thank you so much for this invitation. I'm so excited to present my brand. I'm going to share my screen right now. And please let me know if you can see it. Can you see it? Great. Okay, so hello again. My name is Camila Montoya. I'm the founder of De Francisco. We are a sustainable jewelry brand, as Esno was saying. And with this, and I'm pretty sure many of you here are like sustainability, but what do that even mean, no? Because this is like a word that we lately have been hearing. And this is why I want all of us and use actually the chat right now to write the first thing that comes to your mind when you hear the word sustainability or sustainable. It can be anything. It can be green. It can be even greenwashing. It can be conscious consumer. Anything that you want, just drop it in the comments. And Snow, I don't know if you can help me reading some of the answers, because I don't know if I can do it myself. That would be great. And you can just start reading if people just write something.
So the question here is, what does sustainability means to you?
Yes. What is the first thing that comes to mind when you hear the word sustainability or sustainable, or when something is sustainable?
Mm-hmm. We start to see answers drop in the chat. Longevity, resilience, conscious consumerism, circular economy, regenerative, reduce, reuse, recycle, healthy, empathetic.
Hmm. Amazing. Well, all of those that you're saying, they're actually true. And I want to quote here the UN, and they say that according to them, sustainability is meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. So it's meeting the needs for the present without compromising the future needs. And this actually is pretty straightforward. But as I was saying, I have a sustainable jewelry brand. So I'm pretty sure that some of you right now are asking jewelry, but you know, like, why jewelry? Why should we even care about jewelry? Isn't the jewelry industry sustainable? Like, we have such small pieces, like, are they not even sustainable? And when I had this idea before I launched the brand, it was shocking for me to read something that I'm just gonna show it to you right now, and I'm pretty sure it's gonna shock you as well. And it's over 180 million tons of toxic waste is dumped from mines every year, 180 million tons. And I know that sounds a lot, but I think it's better when we put it into perspective. So let's do that. And it's the 313 million people who live in the United States send about 120 million tons of trash to landfills every year. So the 180 million tons is even more than what the entire US sent to landfills, send trash to landfills every year. And this is huge, knowing that the jewelry industry is it's one of the main ones that use the mines to create all of the pieces that you're seeing out there. So I knew that if I wanted to create a brand like De Francisco, I needed to do something different with the production. If I wanted to call myself like a sustainable entrepreneur, or even call the brand like sustainable jewelry. And so I knew that before, but then I'm a designer, and I'm pretty sure many of you here are either a designer or are in this similar field, artists and things like that. And you're like, okay, but what about the design? Like, do we even need to care about the design when we're thinking about sustainability? And this was another thing that when I was doing research, it shocked me again. And is that 80% of the environmental impact of a product is decided on the designer's table. And this for some part, it sounds amazing because we have the power as designers, as artists, to create something different, to actually create something that is more sustainable. But at the same time, we have a lot on our plate, because actually we have the power to decide if we want to create some products or services that are either sustainable or not. So knowing that, I had two main questions, and I had, what am I even designing, and how I'm even designing it? And so I start with the what. And with this one, I want to tell you a little bit about myself. I come from Colombia, and I don't know if many of you know, but Colombia is the second most biodiversity in the world. So it's the second most biodiverse country in the world, meaning that we have a lot of animals and plants. And so for me, as soon as I move out of Colombia, I had this necessity to show my culture and express. And what better way to do it than actually show our biodiversity? So this, in terms of like my personal experience, was great, And then at the same time, I was like, okay, this is a really good idea to show about sustainability. Let's use our role in fashion, or in jewelry in this case, to educate consumer in a fun way. So using the jewelry pieces that you see, and represent nature, so animals and plants, to show and educate consumers the importance of protecting and respecting the environment and all living beings. And this is what we already have with the watch. So we were producing the pieces, we were designing pieces that also will represent any animal or any plant that actually we need them to live. Even the smallest insect, we need this insect to be in this planet pretty much. So we have the watch, we have the biodiversity portion, and then we're like, okay, how are we even designing this? And the first circle that you're seeing right now, where it says jewelry brands, this is what a normal jewelry brand uses to actually design only one piece. All of these steps, you need the raw materials, you need to prototype, you need to sketch, you need to prototype again, you need to prototype again until you get to the portion where you actually cast it in metals. And so, thanks to my background, I have a background in architecture, and I actually did like a lot of research on 3D printing technology, and I worked myself a lot with that. I was able to utilize that knowledge and be like, okay, so now I know that I can use my 3D printing technology and I can actually design all of the pieces in 3D to cut some of the steps to be able to be more sustainable. And so with this one, we were able to cut the three down in grade that you're seeing in the second circle. The fourth one, that is the raw material, we're gonna talk about it in the production side. But then we were able to cut all of the prototype portion because we designed everything in the iPad before we even printed. We're able to see it in all of the faces. And as soon as we're ready, we just print it to get it in resin, and then we can cast it in recycled silver that we'll talk about in a minute. And the last circle that you're seeing is how our process is now to create each of the pieces. So as you can see, we're able to cut in four steps and make it even more sustainable. So to circle back a little bit, in the design portion, we have the 3D printing technology, that is the how, and the education, that is the what. So we had pretty much the design cover. And then for the production, and this is when I was telling about the raw materials, let's go back to that number of 180 million tons of waste every year of metal, of like mines. And it's like, okay, we have metal for many things. I don't know if you know, but we have silver, gold, copper in like TVs, we have in computer, we have in cell phones, we have in x-ray films, we have in many things. And we're just sending that scraps to landfills. We're not doing much with that. So what if we extract those precious metals from other used metals and we give another life to that? And with that, we can control many things. We can protect the species. We can control the impact of the water. We can reduce the greenhouse emissions. We also can control the mercury emissions. So it was great. So we were able to utilize the metal that is already out here and give it another opportunity. But this wasn't easy, to be honest. It took me 3 years only to launch the brand. It took me three years to do all of the research, to actually create the business plan, and to find people that were willing to work with recycled metals. In my case, mostly we're using recycled silver, but we're opening to use also recycled gold, and maybe in the future other metals. And so let's go back, and we have the design portion, that is the 3D printing technology plus the education, and we have the recycled fine metals, that is the production. So far, actually, this sounds pretty sustainable to me, and I was about to launch the brand, but then I was like, I have a website, so all of my sales are mostly online, meaning that I need to send the pieces to every one of you that order anything from our brand. And this is Before, I just wanted to show you the process of how we create one piece. So this is how we have it in the 3D. This is how we see it in the iPad. We can see it in all of the different sites, as I was showing you. as soon as we 3D printed, this is how it looks. This is in a resin. And then later we cast it, as I was telling you, in recycled silver. Same silver, you know, is just much better for the environment because we're reusing what we already have here. We don't need to harm the environment. And this is as soon as it's out of the oven. And then with all of the finishing and polishing, these are ready to be sold for any of you that want it. And this was our first collection that it was inspired by beetles and fern. And this is a beetle, our XL beetle earrings. And so again, let's go back to the packaging. So we have the design, we have the production, but then we're like, okay, so what are we doing with the packaging? And this was again when we started doing research. And we were able to create an eco-friendly packaging. All of our fiber pulps used in our boxes are 100% chlorine-free. All of our boxes have two certifications granting a World Forest Management. The inks are cobalt-free and mineral oil-free. As you see, all of our little box inside the big one is green. And these all of the inks are like that. The pouches, like inside of the green box, you're not seeing it right now, but have like a little pouch so we can put the piece right there. And all of those are made with reusable filling. And we also add a postal from Colombia to you and a little book. And both of them are created with seeded paper. And this is how it looks, the postal. This is a picture of any either a plant or an animal from Colombia took it in Colombia, as you can see it here. This is the front, and then in the back, we always like to write, so a thank you note for you to becoming a more conscious consumer and to joining our community to actually start kind of like changing the way we consume fashion, and in this case, jewelry. So this is how we actually start creating a brand that it was kind of like a circularity where everything was as sustainable as possible. So to go back to how it looks overall, our brand, we have the design portion that is the 3D printing technology. We design all of the pieces in 3D. We're able to reduce the wax weight by 80%. And then we have the education portion, but using our designs to educate consumers on the importance of protecting and respecting the environment. We, all of our pieces are made with 100% recycled fine metals, in our case, mostly silver, but we're able to design a couple already like 100% recycled gold pieces. So that's a huge one new that we're just opening a new market. And we have an eco-friendly packaging where you actually fill in the tropics as soon as you open the package. But at the same time, we wanted to do as sustainable as possible. And this is how overall the Francisco looks. And I would love for everyone and anyone, if you have any question, if you want to check our website, feel free to do so. If you want to email me, feel free to do so as well. If you want to open your phone and follow us on Instagram, well, it will be much appreciated. I think it's really important for all of us to become more conscious consumers, to learn from one another. And this is what we're trying to do with the brand, not only to sell pieces that they don't only look good, but they also will make you feel good because we're changing as a whole the entire industry. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Camila. Wow, it's a beautiful story and beautiful journey. We'll give folks some time. If you have questions, put in the chat. So Camila will stay to the end of the presentation. You'll have a chance to ask questions and communicate with her in person, not in person, like on yourself. And I'd like to introduce our next presenter while you're putting your question in the chat. So Aditi Mukherjee is the founder of Not Same Equal. Not Same Equal uses regenerative, soil positive, natural closed loop fibers to make socially responsible, universally relevant, and space making products. It envisions a world where all people are empowered to live up to their best potential and co-create circular value with the best in people, their actions, and their environments. Aditi, when we first heard of the name Not Same Equal, is such a interesting name and idea. We cannot wait to hear about your story.
Thank you so much. I'm so grateful to have this opportunity, and I can't wait to share my presentation with you. All right, let me just share my screen.
Yes.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Pratt Earth Action Week. I'm Addie, and I'm so happy to meet you. Let me introduce myself and tell you more about how Not Same Equals started. I grew up in New Delhi, except for that 1 year that I went to school in Colombo. And then at 17, I went to design school in Ahmedabad and then worked in Mumbai and Delhi for a few years. At 24, I moved to New York City to study design management at Pratt. Moving from the East to the West was a big deal for me. The West was aspirational. And so searching for the ultimate validation, after graduating school, I joined corporate America in 2011. There, I learned to straighten my hair, wear synthetic clothes, heels, and tailor my accent. I wanted to fit in, but the environment emphasized appearances, and blending in wasn't easy. So feeling rebellious, I made my first pair of anti-pants, my own private stand against tight synthetics and fitted polyester, an item of clothing that de-emphasized the shape of my body and gave me space to be at ease. Unlike regular pants, these were so comfortable, I wore them every day. People started stopping me to ask me where I got them. So I made a few more and I gave them away. I learned that folks were practically living in them. So I thought it would be a good idea to see if I could turn them into a business. The shape of these pants reminded me of the Roman architect, Marcus Vitruvius, who said all great buildings are strong, functional, and beautiful. And because this was true of the pair I had made, I named my anti-pants the Truvian. My Truvians made me feel strong from within without feeling uncomfortable, highly functional as I could do anything in them, and beautiful day or night in New Delhi and New York. This formed the basis of my business. Not Same Equal products would have to be strong without being harmful, functional long-term, and beautiful for everybody, anywhere. After a lot of research and development, using only soil-positive raw materials, circular product design methodology, and socially equitable production processes, in December of 2019, I launched two versions of the Truvian anti-pant, one style of top to go with them, and two kinds of shawls, a versatile set of products that promise to shift paradigms together. When I sold out of my Truvian stock a second time, I set up systems to circle value back. First, I set up systems to share back profit. Then I set up a material return program so that when done, my customers could have the choice to send their worn out items back to me and get an incentive to shop again. We were at the height of the pandemic, and it was the right time to maximize the value being generated by our products and share it with the localities that made them. In this process, I learned how to create circular systems that generated strong, functional, and beautiful value sustainably. It all starts with soil-positive raw materials, such as wool, which I learned can only coexist with its own locality. Creating symbiotic relationships within the community, all of which can be leveraged using circular design methodology and socially equitable manufacturing processes for products that are then also packaged sustainably and priced appropriately so that they can be marketed and sold to then be shipped and delivered to hopefully be used and valued well. Value that can be then circled back to support more equitable processes that utilize even more soil positive materials. In NSE's first 2 years, I was able to utilize 4 ecologically responsible raw materials, launch 7 economically beneficial product categories. We shared 44% of our gross profits with 12 local community initiatives that were also working with ecologically responsible raw materials. What had once begun as a means to claim space for just myself had become a vehicle that makes space and shares value with everybody involved, from soil to soil, to create an environment where everybody has the freedom to be who they are, so that they can be the best of who they are, over and over again. The earth is our one common ground, and what goes around comes around. Thank you.
Thank you, Aditi.
Thank you.
From soil to soil, no wonder you're the speaker for Pratt Earth Action Week. Thank you.
Thank you.
I like to learn more about your pricing strategy when you talk about bring more wellness to people, but we will leave that question to the end. So our next presenting group is a group of presenters. They are an award winner, Constancy, Combating Food Insecurity Among Pregnant Women. This project won the 2022 Core 77 Design Award, Community Choice Prize in the Design for Social Impact category. Wow, congratulations to the team. It was a capstone project at the time, and we're happy to have you here to celebrating your success for your awesome, amazing progress during the capstone process. And I heard that you're also taking this project to the next step. Let's welcome to the award-winning team. We'll pass the floor to Tito, Grace, Fumiga, Sabrina, Jade, Grace. Welcome.
Thank you.
Alrighty, well, good afternoon, everyone. Together, we are Team Constancy, and we appreciate you for being here today to hear us talk you through our presentation, focusing on combating food insecurity among pregnant women. So to help you better understand our project, we have laid out our project by going through a brief introduction and overview of the problem, our area of focus, contributing factors to the problem, our solution, and a brief conclusion.
So the first question we want to ask you is if you know the effects of malnourishment during pregnancy.
What if I told you that because they went to bed hungry, their babies are now prone to have a chronic disease as an adult? And not only that, but their grandchildren as well. This unfortunate fact is a huge problem.
On the other side of the spectrum, one out of every 3 pregnant women is overweight. This again has the same negative effect. Their children and their grandchildren will most likely have a chronic disease.
So when looking at pregnant women, we understand that the choices mothers make in regards to their nutrition not only have a detrimental effect on them with higher exposure to pregnancy complications, but can have lasting impacts on their children as well, starting from conception. And this leads us to our primary question. To what extent can design thinking innovate and improve the journey of pregnant women's access to nutrient-rich foods and be supported by nutritional education and community programs?
So through our research, we wanted to identify barriers in a pregnant mother's journey, explore existing programs in their communities, and look at the impacts of poor nutrition during pregnancy.
So we take a look on an overview research of the food insecurities to find the areas that are in need. We have taken a look on 3 different locations that have a high rate of food insecurities and poverty. And as you can see, there are 40% of people in Puerto Rico are hungers, as well as the Black and Hispanic women are also in the high poverty rates. That are like 46%. While in New York City and Miami are also remain as a high rate of food insecurities at 10%.
So we also looked at the March of Dimes report card, which grades US states, Puerto Rico, and 100 cities on preterm birth rate. Out of the three areas that we chose to focus on, we see that Puerto Rico had the worst score of an F. This report actually looks at things such as infant death, social vulnerability, and state efforts on Medicaid expansion and other factors that kind of really look at how policy solutions can make a difference. In looking at this report, we realized that mothers are not really meeting their basic nutritional needs in this community, such as iron, fiber, carbohydrates, amino acids, and certain vitamins.
So Puerto Rico is a beautiful island in the Caribbean that is known for its warm weather, blue skies, and breathtaking seaside locations. Being a Caribbean island also means that we are prone to natural disasters like hurricanes that diminish our resources and create an island on its knees that searches for a permanent solution to its food crisis.
So through all the things that we just outlined, it shows us that there was an immediate need for us to improve access to things that can aid in a pregnant woman's journey. Half of the population in Puerto Rico lives below the poverty line and is unemployed. And the most underserved community that is affected by these two things are women who are between the ages of 25 and 34.
The first contributing factor to food insecurity in Puerto Rico is that it's prone to natural disasters. Just in 2020 alone, Puerto Rico suffered 3 earthquakes. However, it was Hurricane Maria who devastated the island on September 20 of 2017. A major cause was the destruction of crops, which has caused the island's locally grown food decrease to an alarming 15%, a number that was 55% in the 1950s. And even during the making of this project, Puerto Rico was really affected by Hurricane Fiona, which occurred just 2 weeks ago. Major flooding occurred, which destroyed 90% of the crops.
Puerto Rico imports 80% of its food. This directly impacts how much food costs and also nutrient levels. As Sabrina just mentioned, this wasn't always the case because in the 1940s, Puerto Rico had a very big agricultural economy. This decline has been fueled by U.S. policies and initiatives, which have shifted the island to a manufacturing economy. By 2019, the agricultural sector of the has only represented less than 1% of the Commonwealth's GDP.
So in 2020, the median household income in Puerto Rico was at $20,000, compared to a medium household income of approximately $60,000 in the U.S. mainland. This means that nearly half of the population in Puerto Rico live below the poverty line, and unemployment on the island is 40%, which is the highest in the states.
And so it was further proven that 33% of the population older than 18 faced food insecurity, and 21% actually said that in the last 12 months, they had to cut off their regular portions due to low income. And finally, studies also show the percentage of food insecurity was significantly greater in women than in men. This further showed how important it was for us to prioritize the communities in Puerto Rico first and use the resources that we have access to support the women there.
So according from all these reasons that my teammates said, it makes the people in Puerto Rico, especially for new generations, lack of awareness in the benefits of locally grown food. And these problems can lead to, you know, it can lead them to have a great trade in the future if people still don't have an awareness on how the importance of food dense and the sustainable agricultures are.
So location is the factor of food insecurity in Puerto Rico. There are a few local food assistance programs available on the island. However, their locations are not equally distributed. So in the case of Arecibo, which we have on the top left on the map, it represents the highest risk of food insecurity in Puerto Rico, which is 40%. And the nearest food assistance program is located an hour and a half away. This possesses an accessibility problem because it requires women to have access to transportation to get to these locations, which then becomes challenging for them to get to the resources that they need to maintain a healthy pregnancy.
So SNAP is a need-based program that uses federal funds to provide money to the states. NAP is a block grant program, which means that federal funds are provided in a specific quantity to the island of Puerto Rico for a period of time, no matter if the needs exceeds this quantity. This means that eligibility guidelines are higher to make the money last more, and this means that some women are not eligible.
So there are plenty of blank spots in the system that minimizes the access pregnant women are having to nutritious food on the island. And there are very few initiatives out there that connect low-income communities to our local produce. And this is the case of Ian Pagan, who we have here on the left. He founded Josco Bravo Farm. He's frustrated about how agriculture is perceived as little worth on the island. And his goal is to create a shift in the way that consumers view locally grown organic produce. On the consumer side, we have Camila, who is currently 6 months pregnant and is working in person every week. She wakes up one morning feeling more tired than most days. She realizes she's out of food for breakfast and doesn't have time to go to the store and make it to work on time. Swallowing her hunger, she prioritizes work. During lunch, she spends extra money dining out, and after her long work day, she goes to a grocery store. Having spent money to dine out for lunch, she opts for cheaper meals consisting of pasta, heavy cream, cane tomatoes, and bread. Only after she arrives home does she realize she didn't buy enough vegetables for her meal. Being so exhausted, she cooks with the material she has. But what if there was a solution that could connect Camila to nutritious food with the help of professionals?
So our primary solution consists of developing a constancy mobile health tour that will be developed in the areas that are most food insecure in Puerto Rico. To do this, we will be partnering with Hospicio Healthcare San Lucas, which is a healthcare center that comes as a direct branch of the San Lucas Hospital in Puerto Rico. Our goal is to reach Black and Latina pregnant women who are not able to access nutrient-dense food for themselves and their babies, and to help connect them with primary resources such as healthcare providers and local farmers.
So our physical channel solution is three-pronged. We will be connecting these three primary stakeholders to our end user, which is pregnant women. The first are health professionals, which will create a network in which food insecure pregnant women establish a relationship with these healthcare professionals to receive some guidance on their health needs. Constancy will be the intermediary that will connect the gap between health professionals and local farmers in order to provide meal prep kits according to doctors' recommendations. And then with local farmers, we want to support our product through pop-up cooking demonstrations across the island. So our goal here is, instead of making our users always come to us, we will come to them with resources and knowledge that mothers can use forever and also pass on to their children. We wanted to really focus on integration with doctor's visits that will generate awareness. What's very essential to our brand DNA is trust. We'll launch a partnership with local organizations in Puerto Rico that are providing health services to our target user. Two organizations that we've identified are the San Juan Regional Nutritional Center, which offers free of charge healthcare consultations, and the Latinx Healthcare Advisory Committee, which is a local volunteer group of residents and partners with Peace Help as a way to improve health and access to health care among 41 local communities.
So in addition to our physical channel of distribution, we also offer a supporting tech solution called Dango. Dango merged a food delivery service inspired by a food prescription model that provides a meal prep kit to pregnant women in need of nutritious food. This addition will be of crucial use when we meet with this woman during our mobile units and for getting access to this service again after meeting with a designated physician.
Looking at our distribution plan, we want to highlight there are two ways that that our user can have their food delivered, either directly to their home, or we will host locations where they can pick up their meal kits. This will allow them to order their desired food within 48 hours. Drivers will drop off food to us, where we then distribute to our end user.
And so in addition to not just food distribution programs, healthcare professionals, and community organizations, it's important for us to partner with local farms as well, so we can enable we can provide the resources to community through locally sourced food. And so here are a couple of four target farms that we definitely want to reach out to, which is Aurora Farms, Thornbush Farm, Seagate Farm, and Fusion Farms. So I'll just call out one of the farms on this list here, but Fusion Farms is actually building towards a more modern, sustainable, and most importantly, hurricane-protected indoor aquaponics farming solutions, which means that they are less prone to getting their produce damaged by hurricanes, like, for example, Hurricane Fiona and Maria. And so moving more toward an innovative solution as well.
So there are two existing food distribution programs that have the potential to partner with in terms of the possible logistic and distribution. The first is Gooder, which they pick up the surplus food from businesses and donated to the local nonprofit organization in Puerto Rico. While the second is Produce, which is created to help the restaurant to receive the local ingredients and prevent the disorganization problems on Puerto Rico food productions. So in terms of the sustainability impact to local economies, we highly believe that this will enable the circular economies in Puerto Rico, where benefit pregnancy women and her household to be enabled to receive the high quality of foods and with a low price, right? While in terms of the local farmers, I still get this benefit from not just letting the good food expire. Finally, the nutritionists and the dietitians will play an important part in this circular economies, to guarantee that all the target people in Puerto Rico communities will remain healthy.
So through the solution, we want to tackle three UN SDGs, zero hunger, good health and well-being, and decent work and economic growth. We look at this as a way to really utilize, promote, and increase awareness about the benefits of locally grown food, with our target end user, but also on the island as a whole. And we see that this is an opportunity that could potentially bolster Puerto Rico's economy.
So there are three potential funding sources that we are considering right now. The first is grants and impact investing from both Puerto Rico's and the US organizations. The second is to partner with the local restaurant and hotels that to share the benefit and margins. And the last way would be the crowdfunding campaigns.
So we want to create a stronger food sharing culture where people can get access to nutritious food and inspire and empower local farmers that food can be used for the benefit and redistributed to those in need. And by enabling these three different stakeholders in agriculture, health, and the beneficiary, we can really build a community that can create awareness for all parties and for a brighter food secure future. And so this is kind of an exciting part on some next steps. We're going to pilot in Puerto Rico. We actually have a lead with one of our potential partners, Produce. So we intend to continue conversations with them and begin implementation of the process. But with any model like this, we want to also know, how are we being successful? Are we actually helping our communities a lot? So we want to make sure we measure against our KPIs and review which parts could always be iterated upon. And lastly, we want to scale our model after the pilot. So we as a team didn't build this model just for the intention of launching only in Puerto Rico. There are many food insecure communities all around the world. And that's also why we looked at New York and Miami as potential future locations to launch this model in. We are a team constancy full of diverse members in this group. And we want to thank everyone for the support and for having us here.
Thank you. Wow. Congratulations again for winning the award. Yeah, big congrats. And also your project demonstrated our 4D process. You just demonstrated us how to discover the challenge, define the pain point, design the solution, and also deliver the whole package with beautiful visuals and good storytelling. I feel the user journey and with a visual presentation help us get into the narrative a lot. So thank you for this presentation. So later on, we'll have the opportunity for folks to ask questions and communicate with our presenters. And I also like to introduce a few of our faculty members who also join us today. We have Mary, chairperson of the program at Creative Enterprise Leadership, and Denise Tahara. Professor Tahara is the advisor of a few of the projects here. We are the all-star advisor. Yutaka is here. Professor Takura helped us coordinate this event for Pratt Earth Action Week. And also we have our colleagues from the Sustainability Center, Tetsu and Carolyn, joining us here. So thank you all for spending a beautiful Tuesday evening with us here and meeting our innovators. We have a few questions dropped in the chat. And if you don't mind, I would like to invite you to ask the question yourself. So if you don't mind, and now all the audience, you're very welcome to turn on your camera and meet our presenters. I saw a question from Purumi. So is that a question to Aditi about, would you like to ask yourself?
Yeah, it is both for Aditi and Camila. I guess like I'm curious what was your biggest challenge or challenges as you started your business, and you know, like also like I guess this is more for Aditi. What are your thoughts on recycling or repurposing materials like plastic and make it into clothing? And also this is for all the groups, like how do you differentiate yourself from other sustainable brands as like the market is like really saturated with sustainable brands and a lot of like companies now are going green. Like, so I guess like, how do you differentiate yourself? And this is mostly for the last group, Core 77 group. How can your solution limit plastic waste? So I wrote them all in the chat. So like, I guess like, I'm not really sure like how we can kind of like discuss this. We can go one by one if you want, or whoever wants to start the discussion. It doesn't matter if it's like going.
Yes, we just put them back to the classroom again, like answer one by one, testing time.
I mean, I can actually jump because I think the first one, it will be the one that I can kind of like answer. Thank you so much for your questions. And I mean, I think overall, I can say but that being an entrepreneur is like you're always challenging yourself to do more and do more and do more. But overall, something that I always go back to, and I have talked to Mary millions of times and to other people here, to Amber and whatever, is like production is a thing that I have to always go back and redo my business plan again and again and again, just because I decided to do it with recycled metals in my case. It's not that easy for me to find people that are willing to work with that. I produce everything in Colombia. And so for me to bring pieces that are already like 3D printing, so they're not flat, they have, you know, like a, I mean, they're actually like in 3D. So for them to actually cast it is a new thing. And then after that, it's like, oh, and I'm asking you, let you recycle metals. And so for me, production is always challenging. I think when you start growing, you always need to go back and like do research on production. How can I improve production? How can I can make it faster? But at the same time, keep it as sustainable as possible and keep it as detailed as possible, because the quality, for example, for me that is in jewelry, it has to keep being as perfect as if you were designing one piece. But right now you're designing even more and you're creating more. But overall, being an entrepreneur is an entrepreneur is a challenge that you, I mean, you learn every day, and that's the thing that I think it's amazing. You get out of your comfort zone every single day.
Thank you.
Thank you. You know, for me, it was the most difficult thing, even till this day, has been digital marketing. It has been, you know, since I launched the brand December 2019, and then the pandemic hit. So we were in crisis, and how were we going to morally talk about ourselves in the middle of crisis? So I didn't know before I launched that I had to actually, becoming a business owner was meant you had to become a content creator, a photographer, a pusher out of content every day, learner of all the marketing channels and the social media channels, and to motivate yourself enough to do it every day, because you can't, I mean, you're really vying for microseconds and attention online, constantly trying to move, get people aware of who you are and what you're doing, and move them into the website, convince them to buy something, and do it again and again and again and again. And then you have, and you know, it was especially difficult to find ways to work with systems like Facebook that became increasingly hostile to small business owners, people that don't have big budgets, or too much time. So Facebook, that immediately became pay to play, and then it just became pay more to play more, get more attention. And their ads platform is a little, I have trouble trusting their ads platform because they own all of the data and they own the reporting. So it became, after a point, it just became, well, if we're going to be able to create an economic engine and make a sale, but then most of that money coming in is going into ads, then what's the point? So I guess that's still hard. So I have to constantly find new ways to talk and market. Without marketing, no sustainability, because you need economic engine to make something happen, for it to prove itself. And so if you don't do that, if you don't get a sale, then no matter how much good intention you have in the beginning, it's over. So that's been the most challenging thing in all of this.
Thank you.
Thank you. And also we have a few questions to the Puerto Rico group. We have a question from Mary and also Niv. Is that Niv?
Yeah, it's me.
Yeah. Would you like to ask your question?
Oh yeah, sure. We weren't sure who was gonna answer, but I can start. One of our team members actually lives in Puerto Rico, and we've been communicating with her, you know, ever since, you know, for the past 2 years, but especially during recent times. And one thing that we have been discussing is looking at ways in which certain organizations like Fusion Farms, how do they remain hurricane resistant? Where are areas that are a little bit more hurricane resistant in terms of their crops? I don't know if anybody else wants to chime in, but it has, especially since it's been so recent, it has been something that has been on our minds lately.
I think to add on to that as well, we could implement more urban agricultural techniques or share
such knowledge somehow to farmers, because I think some of the main issues too with produce getting wiped out is in rural agriculture, because there are no barriers to protect the produce. They are a lot more vulnerable to heavy rain, or some produce can be also very temperamental. So I think somehow we've all been talking about, like Jade said, like implementing a way to connect this new gap that we see between natural disasters and produce is, yeah, something we've been thinking about.
I think I can add to that I don't think there's enough education out there in terms of like the island, in terms of green energy, renewable energy. And it's interesting to see that some farms have been experimenting with that. For example, Fusion Farms is a hurricane protected aquaponic farm powered by renewable energy. And it's really interesting to see that some farms are really trying to start that new way of like protecting their crops and protecting their harvests, and to see how basically we can expand that education into, you know, communities, farmers, and just ways to see how we can educate them to at least try to prevent, because we know that, for example, my island is very prone to hurricane, but just employing new technologies and with renewable energy, I think that's a way to definitely educate these farmers and communities.
And I also think we had another question, which I'll open up to the team as well, which was how can our solution limit plastic waste? I can take that. Yeah. But our solution dominantly is not to limit plastic waste, but rather surplus food. So today in Puerto Rico, 11,000 tons of waste is actually just left on the land. And it so happens that 40% of that waste is food waste. So that's where we thought about it. We were kind of thinking deeply that we see that food waste is a problem, but it's not inherently directly tied to food insecurity. But is there a way we can sort of dig deeper to come up with a solution that can include this? And what we ended up stumbling on was that there are a lot of shelf standards for produce to be in supermarkets or groceries. So even if an apple is edible, but it doesn't fit the color of red, then that's immediately thrown out. So with farmers wasting these surplus foods that are technically edible, how can we redirect them to communities who actually need food and are in food insecure households? So that was kind of our priority, not so much plastic waste.
Yeah. But also to add to that, I mean, if we look at how many foods are one of the, another thing that we were trying to solve for was that a lot of 80% of Puerto Rico's foods are imported. So as you can imagine, a lot of those foods are packaged as well. And so how do we, you know, deliver fresh foods, which is then decreases the use of packaged foods as well.
Yeah, I guess like when I was thinking about meal plans, like HelloFresh and stuff like that, like there's so much like packaging that like, they waste, and it's just like individually packaged and so much plastic just to make one meal. So I was curious like how, like if your solution was similar, but now I know it's not, so.
I think that's super valid though, because we were looking at HelloFresh at first, and then we were like, oh my God, HelloFresh is so expensive. And so that was when we were also like, you know, a lot of people in low-income communities can't afford subscription services like that. So we are kind of looking for, yeah. I mean, that's a really good thing for us to keep in mind though, as we think about piloting and all these things about packaging.
I just had another question too. I know you guys told me you have a teammate from there, but how exactly did you focus in on this particular area? Because it's not something you people usually tend to look into.
Yeah, it actually took us a while to get there. We actually started around August of 2021, really just looking at food and in general, and then food insecurity. And we initially thought that we were going to look at piloting some solution, and it wasn't even particularly pregnant women, but some solution in New York. Then honestly, we went where the data led us. When we saw that there was a link between poor nutrition in pregnant women and how that is can be generational, we wanted to look at a solution that could really impact these families head on. And the data really pointed to Puerto Rico and all of the locations that we looked at.
One thing that's hilarious though is like our entire group wanted to do something with restaurants. We were like, oh, we gotta do something with like restaurants and like food. And then we realized like, you know, we were like, okay, we clearly don't feel any passion for restaurants. So we had to pivot to more, okay, so who needs food? And honestly, these basic questions and really helped lead us to all these like more advanced questions that led us to dig even deeper into communities. So we went from like wanting to help children to looking at parents to then being like, okay, that's still a little bit big. So what's a deeper level, like specifically? And then we landed on pregnant women, thanks to the data and Denise's guidance.
I think it's also funny that how deep we went into like every location we investigated. Because we started looking for locations just to have like a reference, but we were still focusing on New York City. And then after we had like all the data together, it was like, this makes no sense. Like we need to like, kind of like Puerto Rico is in a situation in which we need help, like they need help. And so we were like, yeah, that's the direction we want to take.
Basically, it was just connecting the dots. We had all the information lying out there, but we hadn't connected the dots. And once we did, it blew our minds.
That's Hi. The innovator's journey to have the courage to pivot.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Innocent. I don't have a question of my own. I just want to ask, I think there's a question that was lost somewhere in the chat by Yutaka to Camilla and Adi. And it was a question of brand names. Actually, something I was also thinking about, especially with regards to Adi's brand name, not same equal. So Itaka asks Camilla and Adi, how did you pick your brand name?
Okay. My brand name picked me. I think it came from the experience that I was having and the point that I was trying to make that, you know, I was feeling very judged by just like appearances and not looking and not sounding and not being very corporate America or anything like that. But, and yet I knew I was capable. I knew I could work sincerely. And, you know, that really that's where my value was, that my value came from who I was on the inside and not because of what I look like on the outside, you know? And so really to drill that down to its most basic, most truthful concept, that's where the name came from. And I was really trying to figure out how to say it so that I didn't have to explain it. And so then that's how I coined the three words together.
Thank you, great.
And for me, it's kind of different, but to be honest, I entered to the jewelry industry because of my mother. She's a dentist. It doesn't have anything to do with jewelry either, but she started taking classes for fun. To understand the metals and the soldering and all of that. And I joined her. And after that is when I started designing it. And the name of my brand is De Francisco. That is my mother's last name. And so it's kind of like the connection I have with her. And my mother is the one that actually sent all of the packaging when you do an order and all of that. She takes care of that in Miami. And so she's part of the business pretty much. And her name is there.
So cool.
Great, thank you. Camila, my friend, she's dentist. She's doing a jewelry design using the same tool, she said. So some connection. Oh,
yeah, yeah, no, totally. And when I was actually understanding the molds that you have to do to cast the jewelry, it was really similar what the molds that my mom do when she needs to do for the teeth and all of that. So it's actually pretty well connected.
Great, thank you. Thank you both.
Thank you.
Also, in a bit to also capture some of the questions that were in the chats, hopefully not lost. So there is a question, I think one of Pyramid's questions was to everyone, how you differentiate yourself from other sustainable brands. I don't think we've addressed that. And then after that, there is also a question for Aditi with regards to
pricing.
I think this is from Neve. The factor looking at sustainability in costs and having to price your product appropriately and still have money to give back to the community.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe we start from Aditi on the pricing sustainability, then we can go to the question on the question from PrivyMe that has to do with differentiating your brands.
Mm-hmm.
Then we could then go to Bagia's question on aligning your values with your employees.
Okay, so for pricing, I have very strict pricing rules. All our products are priced 2.5 times cost of goods, plus a little bit for shipping, general, and administration. So, and at this stage of my business, which is very, very small business, and I'm doing a lot of the work, it's easy to calculate at that level. That being said, because we produce small batch to stay unwasteful, we create very small batches of our products and multiple orders. But because we create small batch, per product price is a little high because we haven't been able to produce at scale or go to big factories or somewhere else. So that's how it gets that. Price reflects in the price that's listed for the product on the website. Let's say in the future, we are very lucky and that we get a big order from some big place and we get lots of, that we have to produce a lot of products, then per piece, that price will reduce. And so that will then also get reflected in the final price. But in the 2.5 times of my cost of goods, the 0.5 or the 33% of profit always gets shared back. So I calculate using gross profits. And so that money gets set aside first and then everything else happens later, which is why marketing has been such a hard thing to do because all marketing channels are expensive online or production, even something. So for lifestyle brands, et cetera, if you want to make a sale, you're competing with everybody online at the same level. That means you have to have a budget for photography and for packaging and for design and for presentation. Often that budget being spent, if you can lose track very quickly and you can, you know, get carried away. So that's been a little bit of a challenge. Like, how do you present something beautifully that justifies the cost at which you want to sell it without spending a lot of money on. So like with clothes, without, you know, a big photo studio and a photographer and a makeup artist and a stylist and models and all of that, all of the good traditional fashion presentation stuff. So that has been a little bit of a challenge. And in the middle of the pandemic, I was really taking photos of myself in the clothes in a mirror. And so all photos that happened in the pandemic had me with the camera in them. But you know, you live, you learn. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. But Aditi, could you also start us off on the questions with regards to how you are able to differentiate yourself from other sustainable brands? And also, and I know you've kind of touched on this a bit, Bagia's question in regards to aligning your values with employees. So you start us off on that, then Camila, then Constance Group can take it home.
Differentiating. I feel like maybe I'm not so focused on differentiating, but I am focused on staying principled and making hard decisions. So I guess in a way, I hope that if I stay really true to the principles and to the decision-making, that end product will be authentic and will speak for itself. And if you can, you know, no, you can't compete with sincerity. So, you know, if we can create an authentic product that is useful and functional and beautiful, it becomes very, at that point, you stop competing with other brands and you become a community of brands that are all aligned to the same mission and doing the same thing. And at that point, you can become collaborators and then you can cross market and you can, you know, talk about each other. And then together you rise. So, you know, this whole idea of competition also in business, I've been thinking about how sustainable this idea of competition is as well. You know, maybe in the future, I don't know if, I feel like community over competition allows concepts like sustainability and conscious consumerism to live. Because if you're spending all your time trying to beat the other person or beat another business, then you're using a lot of energy and a lot of time to speak on a story that is not a long-term story. There's no impact for that. Once you win, let's say you compete and then you win, and then what? So then I don't know if there's anything that happens after you win.
After you win, you lose.
Yeah, I think so too. You know, now we're having, there's new concepts in business called degrowth, you know, where it's not about the most all the time for always. And there's something to be said about that. Of the sustainable systems that I have now researched and found, let's say around indigenous cotton or let's say indigenous wool, these systems have lived for centuries or decades, the community has grown around that. But the entire community does the same work. They work with the same materials. They all work together. And together, the community produces value. They are not in competition with each other. So if it works at that level, then why would it not work at our level? I guess we'll see.
Yeah. So just before we move on to Camila, just before we do that, could you also touch a bit on your take on Bagia's question? As a sustainable business owner, how do you align your values with your employees?
Sorry, is that for me or for Camila?
Right? Yeah, it's for you. Then Camila is also going to answer the same question. Okay. And the sustainable there's a question.
So because we start our process with material, locality, and processes, we give ourselves the luxury to choose wisely. So let's say we collaborate with our garment producers. They're a small company initiative called Master G India, and they're a training school for women pattern makers, which has traditionally been a male-dominated industry in India. Men are taught how to tailor and sew and cut. Women are mostly asked to embroider and maybe do some stitching. But we found them. And when we found them, we said, this is the kind of raw material we're looking for in people. So we gave ourselves the luxury to choose to work with them. And that choice came before the choice of what product it is that we were going to design. And so a lot of our product design decisions are taken to leverage systems we have already chosen. What material we're going to use, which locality the material is coming from, and who's producing, what does that community look like, what the relationships look like, and is it socially equitable? Is it creating value? And then once that happens, then you can decide whether you want to make a shirt or couture or atelier, like whatever it is that you want to produce, takes those decisions into account. And that's what decides what the shape of the garment or the shape of the product or what that product is going to be. Someone very interestingly asked me, saying, what is the point of making these pants when you can get, you know, you can create bed linens for that will get thousands of dollars, you know, in markets. Okay, but I have not found a producer who hits our choosing category. I have not found a factory or a group of people that are producing A plus luxury linens for bedding, etc., but that are also socially equitable, that are also, you know, employing well and treating people well. So when I find them, then we can decide to maybe introduce that product. But before that happens, those decisions, those three decisions, ecology, economy, equity, that has to happen first.
Thank you so much. Camila, over yes. to you.
Yeah, so the first question is, how do I differentiate my brand, no?
Yes.
Okay, perfect, from other sustainable brands. Well, I think that the education portion, as I was explaining, it's a key to what I want to do with the brand, because I was saying, and you can actually find it many times in the website, is like, we know that the products shouldn't only be look good, but also they have to do good and feel good for the people, for the environment, for everyone. And this is why we actually created everything behind to make it as sustainable as possible. But overall, and if you ask me how I see my brand 5 years or so, I can say for sure that my idea will be to have my own workshop, that I'm able to do all of the process. So I take the computer, we take all of the pieces out, we melt the different metals. And with that, we can start selling to other jewelry business. Because for me, it's like, oh, let's all become more sustainable as an industry. And that way, and with this type of like webinars and all of that, this is my way to educate, like, this is possible, let's make it together. So every time that you're wearing something, you're first choosing quality over quantity. But at the same time, you are, as a conscious consumer, you're actually choosing the brands that are making like an impact for the environment, for the people, for everyone. So that will be my first question answer. And then the second one is, what was the second one?
As a business owner, how do you align your values with your employees?
With employees, yeah. Well, to be honest, right now I don't have any employees. It's me, myself, and I do a little bit of everything. I do have artisans that work on the production, and they give me their prices, and I just accept their prices. I don't come and jump and be like, oh, I'm just gonna pay you this. This is how I work with them. I show them the piece. Normally in jewelry, I don't know how other industry works, but they have like a specific price per gram per metal. So they have a specific price per gram for if they want to work with silver, if they want to work with gold, if they want to work with copper. And with that, I just work with them that well, and I just pay them that. But as soon as I can get more employees to join the Francisco, for sure I will answer you that question for the future. We just launched a year and a half ago. So this is me, and I mean, I'm the owner and the employee and the everything pretty much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for you all for joining us today. And I think it's quite an inspirational night. And you showed us how you keep learning and growing even after graduation. And I believe you'll keep it going. And as Aditi said, that collaboration over competition, community over competition. And the Catalyst Action Network is such a community that we help each other. And the topics here today, we have jewelry, fashion, and food. And I believe your projects and your discovery process will help inspire many other capstone projects and more generations to come to continue this journey. Every day is a Pratt Earth Action Day. So let's put our act together and share our experiences and our learning. And so next year, the Catalyst Action Network is continue to host events and create opportunities for us to connect and learn from each other. So we would love to invite you back, and also some of our program participants who is currently in the program have already started their entrepreneurship journey. So we may also invite them to share, and then we can put our minds, hearts, and act together. So I'm also paying attention to our time. We'd like to wrap up, and there are ways for us to continue to be in touch. Glad to meet you all here tonight. Thank you all for joining us today. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. So grateful to have this opportunity.
Thanks so much.
You're doing such a good job.
Thank you for joining.